And joining us on Hot Copy this morning, we have with us newly appointed Health Secretary Ted Herbosa. Secretary Herbosa, good morning to you, sir.
Good morning, Karen, and thank you for having me here on Hot Topic.
Well, first of all, congratulations. I want to go back a bit. I also asked Secretary Gibot Teodoro the same question. Did you know that you were going to be appointed Health Secretary? How did this come about?
Well, the medical community had been pushing me to apply as health secretary. If you remember, even last year after the president won elections, there were many sectors in the health community that wrote the president to appoint me. And I actually thank them for having their confidence in me. And I'd like to thank the president also and this administration for appointing me to this job, offering me this job. And how can I refuse? I'm also a regular government employee at the University of the Philippines. So when you're asked to do this task, you just take on the challenge and hope you'll be able to accomplish what the president is asking for.
All right. Take us a little bit behind the scenes here. How did you know? Did the president call you? Who informed you?
Okay. I was supposed to have dinner with a Korean doctor. We were talking about innovations in healthcare. It was a meeting Sunday evening. So I was parking my car and my phone rang, my cell phone rang. Someone said she is from the office of the president. I forgot. I got excited. Okay. I forgot to even ask who there was. I said, the president is asking you to come to Malacanang at 4 p.m. Please be there by 3 p.m. That's all. And then she put the phone down. So I didn't even get her name. But as a duty, civil servant, I went to the office of the president the following day. That was a Monday. And true enough, when I was waiting there at the waiting room, I met Secretary Bersamin and some other people, and then the other people that were there. And
Did you have no idea? Wow. No.
And then I thought it was just an interview.
You didn't suspect, oh, I could be appointed. Nothing like that?
No, I was thinking it was the interview because, remember, the people told me to apply. So I was one of the nominees. And my inside information was I'm still in the short list of the nominees. Uh-huh. So I thought it was the interview. You know, I didn't think it was the job offer. I think it was just the interview. So and OIC Verhera came into the waiting room and sat down. So I thought the two of us will be interviewed. I said, it's an interview only. But when we sat down in front of the president started with a statement thanking OIC Verhera for her hard work for the past year. Then I start to realize, oh, what's this? Then he starts to ask me, I want the Secretary of Boss to lead the Department of Health. So then he started to give his instructions already to me and what to do for the Department of Health.
And other than, of course, the obvious yes, what was your exact reply?
I said I was humbled and honored. Okay. To actually serve the administration. I've been a government servant all my life, Karen. You know that. I think I have a 40-year career in the government at the University of the Philippines, at the DOH when I was undersecretary, and UP as an executive vice president, and then eventually now NTF. My last job was a special advisor of the National Task Force, and now a secretary. Parang destiny yata, Karen. Talagang, I don't know what happened, but I had wanted to just teach in the university until I grew old. But we were called to this task. Of course, it's an honor, it's a privilege, and it's an opportunity of a lifetime.
Okay, I'm going to ask about your priorities in a bit. There have been mixed reactions with your appointment. The medical community welcomes it. I think there's no question when it comes to your expertise. That's a given. No less than even Dr. Rogin Solante spoke, and he said that you were the perfect person for the job. They welcome your appointment. Let's talk a bit on how you would win over your detractors, considering that you've been called at one point insensitive, offensive, potentially harmful. These were words used against you. Secretary Herbosa, will there be a new you? What are you going to be like now?
Thank you very much, Karen, because that's my persona. I'm a Taurus. I'm passionate. I get mad immediately. I say things out of my emotion. And my past history, you know that I've gotten into trouble because of that persona. And I apologize if I hurt people because of the things I say or tweet. But I think now I have to be careful. Suddenly, that came to me that I have to control my persona and create a different one. That's going to be hard because I am who I am. I'm Ted Herbosa. Even if they made me secretary, that is my character. But I will try to be more discerning, be able to, because now they've given me a high government position, I'd be discerning on what I have to say and make sure no other people get hurt. Even if what I say is the truth and it hurts other people, I cannot just do that now. So there's the political side of being an official of the government. And probably it's easier for me in a classroom because I can talk in a classroom and teach and say things, for example. But right now, you're in the public eye. So I'd have to be very careful. And I love the way the president's demeanor is. He's very calm. When he was talking to us, I was so impressed because he was cool. He was relaxed. He speaks very well and explains very well. Obviously, the guy is well-read because of the way he was explaining about healthcare. He's not a physician, but he was explaining what the priorities were. So I said, this is the demeanor of a president. And I think he's gotten the respect of other country leaders because of that, because of his demeanor. We came from a previous president, was a city mayor, became president and acted like a city mayor, right? Probably acted more like me, you know.
Okay. You were more like Duterte before. You were inspired somewhat by Duterte before.
Well, no, I wasn't inspired. That was me. I was kind of like an iconoclast, and I would curse. I would shout at people if they did something wrong. That was me. That's my all my life. In fact, the people in the university ask about me because they know I. That's how I teach. I used to teach young, but today we can't do that anymore because of the way it affects mental health of people. You know, when you say something, it can affect the mental health. And mental health will be one of my priorities as well. So I'll have to really change. That's the way I'll have to transform the way this president has called for unity. And I think, Karen, the best place to have unity is in healthcare. Mm-hmm. I'm calling all the campaigns and the opposition. This is healthcare. This is the health of our fathers, our mothers, our grandparents, our children. Let's work together. That's my call. My call is the same call of the president when he was campaigning. Let's unite and let's have universal healthcare. Universal healthcare means unity. All of us will have good healthcare. And I have no enemies. I mean, you can criticize me. That's part of my job. They will throw sticks and stones at me, but I won't break. I have a common goal, and I've said that to people who have been on the other end of the opinion. And I've said, we have a common goal. They're criticizing me because they also want good health care for the Filipinos.
Okay.
If you see sectors that are criticizing me, they know something. I want to listen because I'm the secretary of, I'm going to listen. Don't criticize me. Knock on the door of my office. It will be open. Come to my office. I will sit down with you and I will listen to your angst, to your what complaints us and what you don't want me to do. And I will listen and follow.
All right. Okay. I'm happy. This is the last question related to this particular issue is clearly addressing the allowances of health workers, addressing the exodus of health workers. It's part of your priority. And yet you do have some health workers who fear your leadership, because at one point when you were not yet secretary, you tweeted and congratulated nurses. And in the tweet you wrote, except yung mga nagprotesta. And what's difficult now is you're in a position of power. Protest is an inherent right in a democratic society. So you do have health workers asking now, why him? He resents protests when we protest over so many things. So let's talk about that, Secretary Herbosa.
Thank you.
Are you different now?
No.
How do you feel now? Because you will have health workers protesting. That will not stop. Will you?
Thank you. And that's correct, Karen. Protest is a constitutional right, the right to express what you feel. And that's why my office is open. Before you even protest in the street or curse on social media, I think your first attempt should be due process. Go to that person and tell him, this is what's wrong with what you're doing. Explain it to me and I will listen. Now, when I said that, that's sarcasm. What happens is I was praising the nurses and doctors who were in the COVID wards. wearing their PPEs. Not the nurses and doctors who should be in the hospital, but were somewhere else in the street shouting at the top of their voices. So I need service. I need actions. So that, of course, it's converted to something bad that I was not telling them to protest. The key is, I want you to help. The key is, come with us, join us. It's hard. There's so many patients. There are so many sick people who need healthcare. I used to head the emergency department of the Philippine General Hospital.
Okay, so in a way,
before I became Secretary of Health, I was alarmed because there are now lots of patients there.
Okay, I know that you did apologize in the past for some of your controversial posts, so to speak, and it cost you to resign from UP. But when it comes specifically to the nurses, I think, how do you address that right now? That particular statement of except yung mga nagprotesta. Because now you have, for example, the Alliance of Health Workers, so many other health groups concerned that you are this type of person, that you only wanted to go a certain way. When now a secretary, you are secretary to all.
That's right. That's correct. And that's the difference. That's the big difference. I am secretary to all, and I invite them to my office for unity. I want them to come to my office. I will listen to them. I invite the officers of AHW, Alliance for Health Workers, of HED, the health alliances, of all other groups that are, because they're also asking the same things I'm asking. I want better healthcare for the poor and the marginalized. And this was also the instruction of the president to me, Dr. Herbosa, do not forget those that are in the geographically isolated areas, the indigenous people, the economically poor who cannot have access. We have the same goals. So why are we shouting at each other? Come to my office. Let's work together. Let's have unity. Health, there will be unity. I think in any family, when a mother or father gets sick, when my mother got sick, all of us put in money. All the children put in money together to take care of them. So this is the type of a call I'm calling to these stakeholders, our own stakeholders. There are nurses, our midwives, our frontline health workers. Come to my office. My office is open. I am your health secretary. I will listen to you. Whether I can do everything you ask for or not, there are technicalities, but I will listen to you. And if I think what you're asking for, I can give, we will be able to work for that.
Okay, so we're moving forward now to Secretary Ted Herbosa, as you've said. Of course, being a Taurus, there, you know that you can't express yourself or behave in the same manner you used to. I want to ask you, before I go to your priorities, you said that the OIC, Undersecretary Vergere, expressed what kind of role she wanted to take under your leadership. Would you be able to share with us what role you'll be giving her?
Yeah, I have appointed her. And yesterday we talked about this. So I started running on and working in the department. And she was the first person I talked to in my meetings yesterday. And I gave her a position of the chief of all the undersecretaries that are in charge of our operations of all the different regions, because we have four undersecretaries taking care of the Department of Health activities in Northern Luzon, Central Luzon, Southern Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. So those are five USECs, and she will be on top of them. So she will be helping me. She will be helping me deliver the goals of her experience and her previous job of taking care of the caretaker of the Department of Health will continue in that segment of operations. And she requested for that. And I gladly gave it because I think she deserves that.
Okay, so you're off to a good start then, at least in the Department of Health, right? You wouldn't have issues right there when you're working already with somebody who's been working at the post for a long period of time.
Correct.
So Secretary Herbosa, what are your priorities? And when I ask you priorities, let's start first with short to medium term. Because iba yung long-term priority, di ba? Pero ano po yung gusto nyong gawin in the short and medium term?
Number one, I really think that the Filipino people needs better healthcare. So I want healthcare access for all, quality healthcare for all people, especially those that are in the lower economic sectors, those that cannot afford a modern healthcare. Because the rich and the middle class, they can afford to go to world-class healthcare in the Philippines because we have that. Those are top hospitals, okay, can compete with the, but I want to address the government. This government wants to address those that are in the marginalized areas, the poor who cannot get healthcare or delayed in getting their healthcare. So that's all embodied anyway in a law that they passed in 2019, the universal healthcare law. And the IRR was actually signed by Secretary Duque in the previous administration, but was not implemented because we stalled with COVID-19. All our money went to COVID-19 mm-hmm. and to fight it. Luckily, it worked, right? We were out of the COVID-19. And this is one of the instructions to me of the president. Uh-oh. Get out of the COVID-19, address the other problems we have.
Okay.
TB continues to be one of the top. Uh-oh. And HIV.
Yeah, Secretary, I don't mean to go general or interrupt you, but can you be specific? So you talk about the universal health care. You want accessibility for everybody. So that's the vision. That's the goal. But what would you do in the short and medium term to achieve it?
One of the things I'm looking at is digitizing and making this organization very efficient.
Okay.
It's a huge organization. And running a huge organization of a Department of Health with regional offices all over, supervising the healthcare of 113 million people, I need to digitize the way we deliver healthcare, the way I run the department, the way budget is spent, and to be able to monitor quickly. All other agencies have digitized. Banking sector has digitized. Tourism. Karen, if you want to travel, you book it yourself. You can book it yourself, your hotel, your tour guide, your uh-huh. museum tickets. I want that kind of tool. The digital tools are okay. there. It's present. We haven't tapped it. We're still pen and paper. We're still traveling mm-hmm. 2 hours to see a doctor mm-hmm. and a barangay health worker. Let's use digital technology.
But is that a medium-term goal, or do you need to pitch for
that's a medium-term goal
because for 2024?
That's a medium-term goal because the elements are there. The government put already a platform.
Okay.
Remember the e-gov, yeah? And yes, all I need is help should guess got to be there. That and during COVID, we did this already. We were seeking consultation with our doctors, with our phones, right? We were getting prescriptions back and we were presenting it to the pharmacy. If I can do that the same for the poor people, they don't have to walk 2 hours to a barangay health station if a phone or a kiosk somewhere can be available to them and they can meet a doctor to actually address their complaints. So this is a priority. In fact, I'm going to have a meeting at 11 for an end-to-end solution for implementing primary healthcare. That means access to healthcare on the first part. And we have some technical people to present to our head of the chief information officer. So the other things I did, I appointed the chief information officer for the Department of Health. And I'm appointing Eric Tayag. Eric Tayag, USEC Eric Tayag.
Absolutely.
Our dancing USEC.
Yeah.
Dancing USEC. It's also been in charge of the KMITS Knowledge Management Information Technology Service in the past administration. And he told me he still wanted to do, because he established the connections with DICT and everything. Yeah. I said, go ahead, that's my priority. And I'm going to make you work and make sure that we digitize healthcare so that it becomes accessible in the most remote areas of the
country. Wow. I'd have to say you made fast decisions within the agency right away, within a day.
Already. Actually, the people here are getting shocked because I'm an emergency doctor.
Yes.
I make fast decisions. I make life or death decisions in split seconds. And my executive assistant is getting shocked. After the day, he said, Secretary, I have 75 things to do, 75 things that I listed that I have to do in the first day of work. So that's how I am. I make a decision fast. I say statements fast. Sometimes it's wrong. Sometimes people will get mad at me. But if I'm able to establish 70 of the 75, let's say, we're all very happy. We're going to accomplish a lot of things. And I'm happy that the Department of Health welcomed me so warmly. It was my return. It really felt like a homecoming. It really felt like you traveled abroad and then you went home. And then everybody was hugging you and embracing you for having come back to the Department of Health. So I welcome that as well. And I want to thank them for their service to the country. The officials are quiet heroes. They're here, they're always bashed, they're always criticized. But you know, it's about time we highlight them. We highlight the hard work of the public doctors, the government doctors that you know, just serve without complaint. for many social media, ibabash sila. Yeah. Nagpunta sa ospital, hindi tingnan, galit daw yung doktor. But they didn't ask, did the doctor have a problem? Was his mother sick? But he had to stay in the hospital and serve them. Those are things we need to highlight.
Absolutely. Okay, and I just want to take this opportunity because you're newly appointed. Is I met with the Philippine Pharmacists Association, I think a few weeks ago, and they felt that we often talk about the lack of doctors in the country, and they say that we are not tapping pharmacists enough in the rural areas. So I'm curious, I'm doing this in behalf of them. Can they meet with you? Because they do want to play a bigger role in terms of helping the health industry in the Philippines. And pharmacists aren't salespeople. They said that's a common mistake. They feel that pharmacists in the Philippines are just salespeople in Mercury Drug or anywhere, when really they took a 4-year course, they understand medication. Is there a way under your administration, Secretary, that they can be part of the health system in a more active manner?
Definitely. I'll ask my EA to call them immediately after this. We were talking about this yesterday. I told them, if you want health for all, the drugs must be available. The medications have to be available. In fact, we listed it as one of my top 3 priorities. Number 3, access to drugs. Okay. And we need to address this because, yes, you have a barangay health center, but if the barangay health center doesn't have drugs, what's that? There's still nothing. Yes, I can do digitalization and you can have a consultation like this on digital medium. But if you don't have drugs, you don't have a prescription, there's still nothing. The patient doesn't get better. So access, public access to the important drugs is an important part of my administration. I'm going to make sure that the Association of Pharmacies, the national organization, will be in line with me and be in unity with the way we want to achieve health for all in this administration.
Okay. Another thing is, of course, you want to address the allowances of health workers. Let me read you some of the data that I have, and you can correct me with this, sir. So there are over 800,000 health workers from local and the national and the private sector that still have to receive their allowances. Of the 72 billion pesos allowed under the 2023 national budget, it still isn't enough to pay everybody, kumbaga may arrears pa po ang DOH. How would you approach this? Is this even doable to pay all the allowances, let's say, in the next 2 years? I mean, something more feasible.
Correct. Sure. So I still, after that question yesterday during my entry to the Department of Health, I asked that the employee, the one in charge of this, explain to me what's the lag. What is the backlog? I heard some comments from the undersecretary in charge that most of those that worked in the government had been given their benefits. It's the private sector hospitals that were issues because they're unable to submit some requirements. So it's a technical issue. And I also have a meeting with DBM to check because this is a commitment of the government to them during the time of crisis. And I will make sure that we continue to have the funding for that. We can look for the funding so that this benefits will be given to them. Because they really work. I saw them. I was going around with Secretary Galvez to all the hot spots. So I was meeting them. And at that time, I was the one talking to the health sector. He was the one talking to the mayors and the governors. So I would know what they really were having. So I really want to fulfill that promise. That's a promise I made when I stepped in. I'm going to do my best to actually make sure that DBM provides that we have all the technical. Of course, there are rules, no? Kasi makukuha naman ako, makukulong. Binigay ko lahat. So they have to fulfill also by the government rules to be able to get those benefits. Okay. So baka para dun sila nagagalit eh. Madaming hinihingi ang gobyerno just to get a check.
Pero you know, problema, wala ring pera eh.
That's why I want to talk to DBM. I think the money, I we can allocate some because human resource is an important part of healthcare.
Yes.
Karen, healthcare is about service. It's about the human touch. Mm. It's about nurses who stay beside patients who are sick 24/7. Sila yung nandoon, kami nga doktor, umuwi sa bahay. Pero yung nurses, they stay behind. We need to pay them correctly. And our nurses are the best in the world. How do I know that? All the countries are trying to ask for bread. That's one thing the president told me. Then every time there's a world leader who talks to me, he's going into, can you give me nurses? Can you supply me nurses? Our nurses are world class. They're being asked by presidents of other countries. They should be serving the Filipino people. We should be the ones paying them the salaries those guys are paying them.
Okay,
so I'm for them. I'm for the nurses.
Let's touch on that a bit now. Very interesting point, Ito. Of course, it's very hard to compete completely.
Yes.
Germany is paying, the UK is paying,
yes.
Canada is paying. But during COVID, we saw that there was a temporary ban on nurses. We're hearing different pitches from lawmakers, let them stay here, mandate it, etc. Kayo po bilang Secretary of Health, and you also are a professional. What is your policy on making nurses stay? Are you putting a cap? Are you allowing a free market? Nasaan ka po ba pagdating dito, sir?
Again, the right for better life is embodied in our Constitution. If a nurse wants to go abroad to get a salary that I cannot give, I shouldn't stop that person. Because what I should look at is why I'm not able to pay the same amount so they can be here in their own country, in their own family, enjoy the beautiful islands of the Philippines. So I will search for the solution of what will make them stay. Mm-hmm. So the question I will ask the nurses who are contemplating to live in another country. You know, I trained abroad as well. Ang hirap ng buhay abroad. Talagang magtatrabaho ka. Yes, they'll pay you a lot, but you're also a second-class citizen because you're there taking their tax money and you're being paid. So you're looked at as a worker, a kind of, a medical slave. That's why I returned. I trained abroad. I returned. I want to serve my country. And I was right. I said, I'd rather be the head of a mouse than the tail of a lion. And true enough, if I had stayed in the U.S., I'd probably be just an ordinary doctor. But here I am after 40 years. I'm the Secretary of Health. What else can you ask for a career? So I fulfilled my idea of coming home and serving the Filipino people. So this is the same passion I want our health workers to have. It's not all about the money sometimes.
Yeah. It's not all about the money because the there are other
sometimes
ways to
sometimes you provide them better work conditions.
Yes. So what is a doable? What's reachable here?
Okay,
right?
So some of my ideas, and I'll open up to you. These are not just plans, but because I'm Secretary of Health, people may think it's policy. But one of the calls I got was a call from the Professional Regulation Commission. He's a commissioner, and he's a doctor. He's a surgeon like me, Dr. Cueto, Jose Cueto. And I told him, Joe, you've got to help me get the nurse, the board eligibles working in government, because we have several nurses that don't pass the board examinations and doesn't have a license. In government, you cannot work without a license. But I'm willing to take them if they have a diploma. I have 4,500 unfilled nursing positions. So I can look that, and I can look at the unfilled positions as a bad news. Wala nang nurse, and laki-laki ng sweldo sa government. Pero, I can look at that as very bad news, walang nurse. Good news, oy, kayong mga nurse, walang trabaho. Madaming trabaho dito sa DOH. 4,500 unfilled positions, government salary. It starts at about 35, 40,000 and goes higher if you have more experience.
So patatanggal mo yung license requirements, sir?
I'll make it eligible. So if you have a diploma in an accredited school, recognized, I'll give you a period of time to pass it. This is the same in the U.S. They accept board eligible.
That's a very good idea.
And then you make them work for 5 years. I'm giving you 5 years to pass the board exam. I'll even mentor them. I'll put out money to teach them so that they can pass the exam. So when they pass the exam, I'll give you the full item of a licensed nurse. So these are some of the solutions we can. So this is under the Professional Regulation Commission. They have to, this is a law. I say I cannot hire in government if you don't have the license. So I have to find a way.
Paano yun, Secretary? Do you have to amend the law?
Yun nga ang pag-aaralan ko pa kasi hindi ako abogado. But the idea is great, right?
Yes, absolutely.
You know where I see these nurses, the board eligible? I see them as flight attendants in the big airlines. I see them in the call centers. They should be in the clinics. They should be in the hospitals. They should be taking care of sick people. They should be in rural health nursing.
Yeah.
I can put them in rural health nursing. Yes. Graduate sila ng 4-year degree. Tapos ang nakuha natin, barangay health worker na tinrain ko na 1 linggo, di ba, na housewife. why can't I get the four-year graduate of a school, of a nursing school, na accredited, and make them work in government where there are no nurses going there, di ba? Mm-mm. So that's an institutional band-aid solution lang ng Karen.
Yeah. No, no, but
it will provide services.
Yeah, if you're able to do that, Secretary, that's a big and innovative shift immediately. I wish you luck on that. Maybe I wonder if you need to amend the law. That's one thing.
Maybe you should interview the PRC or interview the chairman and find out if this, my plan can be done. And I'll sit down with him and then maybe talk to the legislature. Baka it requires an amendment of the law. Isang amendment lang yan. Who will oppose that? I can provide nurses now to your constituents because graduate sila, may diploma sila, nagtoga sila, nagtarat sila. Bakit hindi nila kaya alagaan yung mga taong may sakit?
At apat na taon yun.
Apat na taon nag-aral yun.
Apat na taon nag-aral yun.
Okay. And we're denying them services to serve our people. Let's get them.
All right. Okay. Well, I'm happy that you've said that on Head Start because that might actually take off. I want to ask you this. You talked about COA. You mentioned COA a while ago. And the Commission on Audit actually flagged the Department of Health in the past for what they describe as poor use of the 67 billion pesos in COVID funds, and they said it led to missed opportunities. So one is the issue probably on bureaucracy, urgency, a sense of urgency, the creativity, the quickness, et cetera, on how to use 67 billion. And the other issue you have is alleged corruption, which is formally. So you are taking over these problems too in DOH. There's a lot of money in the health department. How would you change the way the funds are used?
Karen, the way I'm looking at it is, again, my answer to you as one of my priorities. Digitize. Because not only can I digitize healthcare, the banks are digitized. The bills to your cell phone are digitized. I know every centavo if it's wasted or inefficiently used. So I want to also digitize. Maybe the private sector can help me. I know the experts are there. But I want to digitize the financing, the disbursement, and the spending and procurement of this billions of pesos of people's tax money. I want them all to go to healthcare. I've been an undersecretary, Karen, but at that time I saw there's enough money. We didn't have money in PGH, but we took care of a lot of people. I'm going to take that same principle and say, with this money, this is what I'm going to give the Filipino people. And I'm going to use digital efficiency to be able to make sure the COA doesn't come in anymore. Because if it's COA flagging it, something went wrong with the way we did financial management. Yeah. So I'm calling all the financial experts to help me out. There are banking experts who learn how to control this, na walang nananakaw, napupunta lahat ng pera. And it also requires very good planning, a very good strategy, a planned approach of what we will spend for. They were presenting, I asked, that's the first thing, by the way, Karen, I asked for. Mm-hmm. When I sat down, I asked, Yusek Herrera asked me, what do you want to look at first? Show me the money, because that's what will make me ask.
Yeah.
So we addressed the request for 2024. Actually, it's the request for 2024, because the money for 2023 is all done. It's been approved. Yeah. And I saw that they were being denied by DBM for a higher cost of budget. But I think it's because of these issues of COA.
Yes.
If I fix that and I show them, look, this is the new DOH. We efficiently use funds. We are hiring nurses and we are paying them and they're providing healthcare to the people. I think the president will even give me more money. Yeah. We're spending still very low. We're just 5% of GDP. That is the lowest cost of healthcare. Do you know what America or Japan spends for healthcare? It's like 15 to 20% of GDP. I think the US spends highest at 21% of GDP. We're at 5.4, and it only became 5.4 because we spent a lot during Pharmaly, COVID.
Okay.
We spent a lot during COVID, and we need to triple. If you see that, 10 to 15% of GDP for healthcare costs. Karen, it's very important that the Filipino people are healthy. If we want to go up to the economic development, people have to be able to work. You cannot be sick and then stay home. Absent ka, papatingin ako sa doktor. Then you have to take off the whole day. So that's my also idea. If you're in digital, I can be in the office. And if you have some pain in your run, you can consult while in the office. You didn't have to get out of the office and you continue to be productive. So health is a priority. The president's priority is economics. My priority to make sure that the people will be able to work and that they are healthy and they will be productive Filipinos and that the economy of the country will progress.
Okay. Another question here is, let's talk about low vaccination rates in the Philippines, right? So you said no more Dengvaksha, but then we have another problem. Not many people, parents, are bringing their kids to be vaccinated. So we're seeing rising numbers of other illnesses and issues. I don't know if it's an information campaign issue, Secretary, frankly, but how would you approach this? Because that's the foundation to better health. In a way, at the very least, is you don't have kids contracting basic diseases.
That's correct. No? If there is anything, sabi nila, vaccination or immunization programs are the most important public health program. You yeah. don't have to repeat that because I teach that in the university. So mm-hmm. I'm going to look at that. Why is our fully immunized health? We're immunizing about 8 to 9 diseases. These are the vaccine preventable diseases that are proven worldwide. So we have a law that makes sure, and we have the funds. We buy every year all the money, and then we give it to the LGUs. The problem is, I think, operationalizing and implementing the vaccination. And of course, because the LGUs do it, the DOH buys it, they give it and distribute it to the LGU. We've got to improve that system. And I'm going to study that and make sure it reaches, you know, the soft drink manufacturers are able to bring their soft drink correct. To the most remote yeah. barrio. The yeah. beer, they can go to the most barrio. The vaccines has to be the same, that I will be able to have a logistics and supply chain that if a child is born somewhere, they will immediately get their hepatitis vaccine and their BCG vaccine. Problem is, they have to travel hours to get the vaccine. So again, access to vaccine, because the vaccines are being bought. So the other thing is, of course, health promotion.
Yeah,
that's right. People are scared of the vaccines. Social media has not done justice to the most important invention in healthcare, vaccination or disease prevention. Sabi nila yan na magiging kang zombie or and people believe it. Many people believe it. So I'm going to address health promotion, health literacy. So I will work with Secretary Sara Duterte on this. It's important that all aspects of healthcare, whether it's vaccination, right eating, exercise, I need them to educate in the school, in primary school. So they have to learn this so that people will have a stake in their health. We as individuals have a stake in taking care of my health. I was with the president and I looked at our photos after I was announced. Oh my yeah. God, I'm a disgrace to the Department of Health. My waistline is so big. And the president's okay. waistline, he said, I said, Mr. President, I'll ask you a tip. And he said he really exercises. He really takes time.
So are you going to exercise now and diet?
I've already...
You're telling us on the show?
Yes, really? I've already contracted yesterday one of the spokesperson who's a fitness buff. And he said, yes, when put it in my schedule, we'll be in the gym. Okay. And we can actually go on the treadmill, discuss while doing exercise. So yeah. That's my promise too. This yes. waistline is going yes. to go down. It's 44 right. inches. Yes. It's going to go down.
It's very difficult to advocate for healthy, nutritious eating. If you're right, if the secretary yes. could practice yes. it himself.
Yes. Okay. So I'll use the president muna while my waistline is still big.
Okay. So my last question, we don't have enough time. I do hope you come back to Head Start is this.
Sure.
You know, health secretaries are known for different things. They're different personalities. You have the likes of Juan Flavier. Then you also have the likes of Duque. You also have the likes of the other health secretaries. My memory escapes me now. But they're known for something. What kind of health secretary will Secretary Ted Herbosa be?
That's a good question. I also don't know, but I'll tell you what I am. I'm a disaster doctor. Where there's chaos, I go and I fix it. So maybe I'll be that guy. Maybe I'll be that doctor that makes the right decisions and say, this is how we will fix this. This is how we will save lives. This is how we will make people healthy. It's not about the health secretary. It's about the system, the health system. And that's the Department of Health. That's the private sector. That's individuals taking care of their health. That's the education department teaching proper health, nutrition, and exercise. So I think that's what I want to be. I want to be a systems guy.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And be able to make sure that all Filipinos will be healthy. At least after 5 years, they're healthier than they were before I came in.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you so much, Health Secretary Ted Herbosa, for being on Head Start today. We really appreciate it. And we hope to see you soon. And good luck to you, sir.
Maraming salamat. Thank you very much. Mabuhay ka, Karen. Mabuhay to all the Filipinos. Stay healthy, everyone.